my battery's going out, I gotta come up here. Supposed to check those things first, aren't you? Couple of prayer requests just to bring forward to our congregation. We want to extend our sympathies to the family of Victoria Moore, who passed away this week. Her services are still pending, so please be in prayer for all those who were impacted by the life of Victoria. We also ask you to pray for Buck Knapp and Maxine Durth and their families. They are both in hospice care at this time. Mary Ruth Riley is continuing her recovery, and she is at Signature, so if you'd like to stop by and visit, that's where she is. And also, please continue to keep Piper Berth in prayers for healing. She is an infant that has undergone some surgery, so we ask you to keep her in prayer, too. We come here each week, and sometimes we've had an awesome week, and sometimes it is a week that we won't remember, and sometimes it's just a terrible, rotten week. But God has been with us and present in all of those things, good, bad, and the ugly, and God never leaves us. So let's just take a few moments in the silence and hand over to God whatever is on our heart, and we'll finish that up with a morning prayer. So let's just have a moment of silence. God, we thank you for your gracious presence. We thank you that you are so amazing and that your love is so unbounding. We can never possibly begin to measure it. And Lord, it's been one of those weeks, and we just are thankful that you have been with us every step of the way, that you have protected us, that you have comforted us, that you have cheered us on, and you have just been with us. So Lord, we are bold when we ask for our own prayer requests, for the hurts in our lives, for the people who are struggling, for the things that we see wrong in the world. And we know, Lord, you are big enough to handle all of these things. So we hand them over to you and ask you, Lord, just to let your Holy Spirit fill this world so that it can be a place that reflects your love and your joy and your peace. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We remember that last night when Jesus was with his disciples, when they had the last meal together and they broke bread. And when they broke that, when Jesus broke the bread, he blessed it, gave thanks to God, and said, "This, take, eat. This is my body, broken for you." He didn't single anybody out and say, "You're not worthy of this bread," even though one at the table would betray him. He said, "This is for you. No strings. You just get this one." And then he took the cup and he blessed it and said, "This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this as often as you can in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of all that Christ has done and continues to do for us, we come and we feast at this table, knowing that it is a place where God's Holy Spirit fills us up again. So Lord, we ask you just to pour out your blessing upon us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be one with Christ, one with each other, and one in fellowship to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Our table is open to anyone who seeks to grow in relationship with Christ. You're invited to come forward and kneel as you are able and take the elements. If you would like to receive anointing, please indicate to Pastor Joe or I, we can do that as well. And if you are unable to come forward, just raise your hand and an usher will be glad to serve you. The table is prepared. Come and accept the gift of God's grace.
Gracious God, it's impossible for us to understand why you would love us so much. Why you would fill us again to overflowing with grace and new hope and new life. We come today with hearts of gratitude for all that you have done, are doing, and will do until we meet you face to face. Might our lives be a glowing reflection all that you are in us. Grant us the peace of walking with you this and every day. Amen. Our children are dismissed. Remember, you are moving up a level today. It's Move Up Sunday. You can follow Miss Noel off to Sunday school classes. Prepare your hearts as God's word is read in his house once again today.
Our scripture today is from Luke 15, verses 1 through 10. All the tax collectors and sinners were gathered around Jesus to listen to him. The Pharisees and legal experts were grumbling, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Jesus told them this parable. Suppose someone among you had 100 sheep and lost one of them. Wouldn't he leave the other 99 in the pasture and search for the one that was lost until he finds it? And when he finds it, he is thrilled and places it on his shoulders. When he arrives home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Celebrate with me, because I found my lost sheep." In the same way, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who changes both heart and life than over 99 righteous people who have no need to change their hearts and lives. Or what woman, if she owns 10 silver coins and loses one of them, won't light a lamp and sweep the house, searching her home carefully until she finds it? When she finds it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Celebrate with me, because I found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, joy breaks out in the presence of God's angels over one sinner who changes both heart and life.
Technology has beat me today. I probably could print my sermon off and have a copy, so the only copy I have is on my iPad. See how this goes. Hopefully, I don't change the text as I scroll. You have that app? Okay. Let's pray, shall we? Gracious and holy God, it is your day. This is your time. Instruct our hearts, our lives, our souls, our very being. Bathe us in your word, that we might know the way to walk that leads to eternal life. Bless the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts. Might it be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. At a conference held in Houston in 1999, speaker Marty Henson, a missionary to Africa, brought some of his African pastors to the United States for the big meeting. During their free time, these Africans wandered about amongst the city and shop. Even though they were in a small town outside of Houston, Marty knew there was a chance that somebody might have difficulty and get lost. So she gave them her phone number for such a case in an emergency. And in less than an hour, the phone rang, and one of the African missionaries with them said, "I'm lost." Marty said, "Okay, put your phone in your pocket, go to the nearest street corner, find out the names of the two streets on that corner, come back and tell me, and I will come and get you." In a few minutes, he returned to the phone and responded, "I'm at the corner of Walk and Don't Walk." Sometimes this is how life can feel, isn't it? Lost in the corner of walk and don't walk. Now, my dad, when we went on long trips, went to the AAA office and got something known as a triptych. It was a detailed map in which they highlighted every road through every city and everywhere you went. Imagine what our trip would have been like if the triptych got lost or was marked in error. Today, I was going to ask you this question. I think I'm going to ask it a little differently. Say your cell phone's dead and you no longer have access to Google Maps or whatever app that you use for GPS. And you're trying to get somewhere and you realize, I'm really not sure how to get there. How many of us, honestly, by a raise of hands, just keep driving, thinking that we will find a destination in some way, some little marking point, go, oh, I know where I'm at now. It's in those days that I go back to my scouting days and remember, let's see, the sun rises in the east. I got to remember which side moss grows on a tree. I got to remember where to find moss. How many of us stop and ask for directions? Wait a minute now, Katie, you raised your hand in both situations. So. When you totally lost, you finally stop and ask for directions. Today we're going to talk about the lost and what to do with them. Does Scripture find you a bit puzzled this morning? We've heard in the Gospel of Luke chapter 15, the story of the lost sheep, the lost coins, and the prodigal son. The beginning of this book, the beginning of this writing says, and now all the tax collectors and sinners were gathering around Jesus to listen to him, and the Pharisees and the legal experts were grumbling, saying, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. Jesus told this parable. Suppose somebody... Let's pause right there. Because I've heard a lot of sermons, I may have been guilty of preaching them myself. On this yin and yang, Pharisees and legal experts and tax collectors and sinners. And at times, even we're even told of the woman who gives her last two coins, and the Pharisee that's over there saying, ooh. Or the tax collector in the synagogue that comes and he says, Lord, forgive me for I'm a sinner. And the Pharisee that says, oh, but I'm not one of these tax collectors. We all might come to the conclusion that Jesus really didn't like the Pharisees in his day. After all, they would finally convince Rome to execute him. The sinners and tax collectors might be the good guys in this drama. But I read a book recently that says that's a bit unfair. Short Stories by Jesus was written by Amy Jo Levine, a Jewish woman who happens to be the head of New Testament studies at Vanderbilt University. She put a very unique perspective on these parables of Jesus. And today's really kind of caught me wondering. And I don't know how many times I've read the text and never said, now wait a minute. Think for a moment. As you were sitting in the crowd and you hear these words once again. Which person among you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, would not? In Jesus' day, the answer would have been, not me. Which one of us would leave the 99 to go after the one? crowd's response has typically been, that would have been foolish. If I'm watching a flock of 100 sheep, it's normally someone else's sheep and I'm a hired hand. First of all, I have to recognize that the one is gone. How do you do that? I mean, imagine the task of herding 100 cats and trying to count them. Sheep are the same way. They tend to wander. Unless you could mark them. Oh, got you already. It would be kind of strange for the shepherd to realize one was gone. But even when he did, imagine for a moment the utter audacity, unless there's someone else around to go after the one. Isn't that strange? But in Jesus' parable, the shepherd leaves the 99, the comfort of the flock, and goes. And then, having charge over the 99 as well as the one, how long do you think they would have been a hired hand if they did? Leaving the 99 in the wilderness, and going after the one. And finding it, he puts it on his shoulders, rejoicing. Now, friends, I have never heard of sheep. But I'm told they don't like to be carried over your shoulders. In fact, a sheep farmer told the woman who wrote this book, it would have been quite a struggle hauling that sheep, binding its 4 feet around your neck, and walking all the way back. The wrestling with is an interesting idea, and the people of that day would have been, that's a bit odd. Then Luke records these words. I say to you that likewise there will be more rejoicing in heaven at one sinner repenting than at 99 righteous, and those who have no need for repentance. Does the sheep have to repent? What has the sheep done but be a sheep? Isn't that odd? Then he goes on to tell the story of the woman who lost a coin. In many cases, characterized as a marginal woman, but if she has 10 silver coins, she's pretty wealthy in her day. And if you can't recognize the one that's gone from 100, maybe you'd recognize the one that's gone from 10. Have you ever stacked 10 coins up and 9 coins up to see if you could tell the difference? There would have to be an accounting in that situation. And then Jesus goes on to say again, as recorded in the Gospel of Matthew, then there will be more rejoicing in heaven, right? Has the coin done something wrong? Does the coin need to repent? Or is Matthew taking some liberties in interpreting Jesus' parable for us when he records it? When we turn to Matthew, we find these words about the lost sheep. What do you think? He says in Matthew 18, 12 through 14, if someone had 100 sheep and one of them wandered off, would he leave the 99 on the hillside and go in search of the one that's wandered off? If he finds it, I assure you that he is happier about having that one sheep than about the 99 who didn't wander off. In the same way, my Father who is in heaven doesn't want to lose any one of these little ones. There's little ones sitting around Jesus, and the disciples happen to be saying, hey, don't bother the master. Jesus calls them. Could this, or should this, more accurately be named the parable of the ignorant shepherd and the woman who doesn't care about her money? We commonly then follow up in Luke with the story of the son lost. But who has to repent? And then I thought this thought this week. Wait a minute. If Jesus is the good shepherd, as he tells us in the Gospel of John, and if they've heard this story, is it really more about the shepherd needing to repent and the woman needing to repent than a coin and a sheep? I know, you're about ready to charge the stage. Give me a minute on this. If we're the sheep, and the Lord is our shepherd, that we pray in the 23rd Psalm, and one is lost, do we go after it? Or do we wait for God to go after it? I thought about this yesterday. I was in a pre-baptismal meeting with someone who wanted to be baptized, and young lady who's in elementary school, and I told her this. I said, now let me reiterate to you. We're going to ask your parents these questions, and then we're going to ask the congregation these questions. Will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, they may be guided to accept God's grace for themselves, to profess their faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? And then you will be asked to respond in covenant relationship with her and her family. With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround this person with a community of love and forgiveness, that she may grow in her trust of God and be found faithful in her service to others. We will pray for her and nurture her, that she may grow to be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life eternal. Then I thought about Noelle's statement. She's not here. She doesn't know I'm saying this today. That she called over 30 families, 30 people to help in children's ministry. And they all said no. That we vow to be in a covenant relationship with each other, to do all that we should, all that we can, to nurture each other in the faith, and then we let the sheep just walk away. And maybe at times, shake an accusing finger at a staff member or a pastor, that they're the ones that did this. Maybe we're the ones that need to repent. How can we allow our loved ones to walk away? Look around you. Is the sanctuary as full as it has been for you in your time here? Depending on how far back you go, you remember the days when there was overflow upstairs. This place was packed. The statistics show quite clearly that a pastor's effort to follow up in a meeting with a new arrival only leads with about 54% of likelihood that that newcomer or guest would return. But if laity go and they get there within 48 hours of the ending of the worship service, the people are 98% likely to return. The assumption is made you're paid as a pastor to do this. And the other assumption that's commonly understood is, wow, if the laity show up, they must really want us to be a part of it. I sat in my office about 2 months ago, following the second worship service, I looked down on my keyboard and there was a letter. And in that letter, this woman wrote her heart out that this family had walked away from her family. I found out later she joined another church. But her parents remained faithful Methodists with no home. I heard on the radio that you would take communion. Maybe you don't do that with the people that have been, well, gone. But in one last ditch effort, I'm asking, please. Mom's been diagnosed and is in hospice care. Would you come? Roger and Victoria Moore. Her parents were the youth directors here under Reverend Herger, and had not been visited by one person in the church for over 10 years. I don't know how they got off the visitation list. I don't know what happened. I sense there's much more to the story than what I was told. But when I called and took communion to them, the dying woman, Victoria, said to me, "How did you find me?" I said, "Your daughter wrote a letter." She had gone to church in early service at the Catholic Church. She had come to the post office, hates driving by this church every time she has to because the church has forgotten her family. And thought in desperation, "I'm just going to stop and write a note." She didn't even know who the pastor was. She just walked into his office and said a note of desperation. Friday night, while in a meeting here, I got a text from her daughter, "Can you come?" And I went and anointed Victoria, and I asked for her forgiveness for her church. And she passed away Saturday. How many others who have sat amongst us, who he had made this commitment to be a covenant church, to surround and enfold them, even from their childhood, do we just find it acceptable if they just walk away? It's the number one reason why people leave the church. Let's get back to the Pharisees and scribes. Sinners and tax collectors. Because if Jesus is dogging the Pharisees, he's dogging us, the people in the faith, who should be chasing the lost, who are out of the faith. But we tend to set policies that just pacify us and not want us to change things so that the world is more comfortable or more acceptable for someone to dawn our doors. Everything we do should be about making new disciples. Everything we do should be about reclaiming the lost that have wandered away. I don't pray in my prayer time about whether or not we're happy. I pray whether or not there is enough of a movement of the Holy Spirit in this place to chase the lost. Friends, I'm not in a panic over whether or not this church is going to survive because we just let some staff go. I am in a panic over the day you meet Jesus and I meet Jesus. And the panic that I'm in over the day that you meet Jesus is whether or not He says, I know you. And I'm panicked over the day I meet Jesus, in which he says to me, what did you do with my sheep? Shepherd. Friends, we need a turnaround. And that turnaround is going to start with the transformation of the heart. That turnaround is going to be built upon allowing God's space in our lives to chase the lost. And when we do, imagine for a moment the party that takes place in heaven when we get our priorities straight. That it's not about us. And it's about those who have lost their way or have never found it. Therefore, go and make disciples. Jesus' last commandment. Jesus, we're here today. I wonder if you would say, what do you think if someone had 100 congregants and one of them wandered off? Wouldn't they leave the 99 on the hillside to go in search of the one who wandered off? And if they find them and they bring them back, I assure you, they are happier about having brought back the one sheep than the 99 who never did. In the same way, my Father who is in heaven doesn't want to lose one of these little ones.
Again when they joined us in membership classes. I beg you to fulfill that covenant today. Amen.
Mountain that's in front of me.
Some of these are studies on prayer, some are studies on books of the Bible, a wide variety. So if you look at this list and go, I can't make any of these things, then come to me. We'll figure something out. I'll make something work. Okay? If you want to get fed, these are your feeding opportunities. So there are these lovely clipboards. If you are already in the group, you don't have to sign up. Some of these are like, we have our study school classes here. But if you're like, I'm not in, and I really want to study that, that sounds great, put your name here, and I'll make sure that the leader of that group contacts you. I'm going to pick on our leaders just a moment. If you are leading a Sunday school class or a small group or a life group this fall, would you please stand? If you don't, I'll call you out. If you have ever led a life group or a small group or a Sunday school class, would you please stand? I think a couple of years ago. There we go. So if you're not sure about this, going, hanging out with people, learning about Jesus, any of these folks can tell you what an amazing experience that is. We thank you for the way you have served. Sign up. 10 opportunities. There's got to be enough for everybody. Please sign up. When you give to our offering, part of what you're giving is allowing for us to be able to provide curriculum, to be able to train our leaders, to be able just to help one another grow in the faith and to have these opportunities that we can bring along someone beside us that is just so curious about Jesus that they'll come and hang out with us. So as we give today in our offering, please remember the small groups and the life groups and all the ways that we continue to grow each and every day, because our God is just an amazing God who wants to find every lost child and show them how great a life with Him can be. Would our ushers please come forward to receive this morning's offering?
See you.
Jesus said, if you are leading a life group or are interested in leading a life group, and you're saying, you know what, there's just not enough people who signed up, life groups are a wonderful opportunity for us to invite our neighbors, our friends, those who are not yet in the church, to feel the love and the faith of God in His people, and to find renewal in belief in what the church would do. Consider that also as an opportunity of faith sharing. As you go forth from this place, I pray that God would place in your path someone who needs to hear the good news. That you might find the words, the grace, the power to speak that truth, that belief, that hope, that love, and invite them back, or for the first time, into a community of grace. They may come and find healing, respite, hope, and true purpose in life. Make that our mission this week. Go in His grace.